Looking at who is around, most of you know me, but I don't think Simon knows my background very well. I'm a microbiologist, epidemiologist. So I'm interested in expert elicitation as a user, not so much as a technical person looking at the intricate technical details of the methodology, but to get data that I can use in my other research. And Roger and I have been working together since 20 years now. First study was on
Campylobacter. Campylobacter.
Model we were building for Campylobacter transmission during poultry slaughtering. So that was the first study, but since then we've mainly collaborated in the area of attributing foodborne disease to sources. So what I'll do in this presentation is, first of all, give those of you who may not be very familiar with the problem field background in estimating the disease burden of foodborne disease, the burden of foodborne disease, and how attribution fits into that question. And then go through four studies that we did in the past 15 years, using the classical model to inform attribution at different scales in the Netherlands, for the World Health Organization, for CDC here in the US, and in three African countries. So first of all, when you ask yourself the question, what is the burden of foodborne disease, you typically go to surveillance reports. This is an example, probably one of the best developed surveillance systems in the world, from the European Union, who publish what they call a zoonosis report every year. And one of the first tables they always start with is to report the number of reported cases of a lot of diseases that can be transmitted through food, like Campylobacter, Salmonella. These days also more diseases that are associated with food animals, like West Nile virus, so they're a little bit broader these days now, but most of these diseases are considered foodborne diseases, although, and that's what we'll be talking about, they can also be transmitted through other pathways. Now, you might be inclined to think that the difference between the numbers that you see here tells you something about the underlying epidemiology of the disease, so that, for example, campylobacteriosis occurs double in the frequency is about double that of salmonellosis, and salmonellosis occurring 10 times more than yersiniosis. But that is certainly not true. I will touch about that on that in a little while. What these data are mainly useful for is for trend analysis, and that's why the European Union is interested in these data. They have certain regulations in place, and I want to see if these regulations make an impact. For example, in the mid-1910s, they had new regulations for Campylobacter on poultry meat, and the question then, of course, is, does this lead to a reduction in the number of reported cases? And yeah, you see a slight decrease here, then suddenly you see this big decrease here until 2020, showing that even the trends in themselves do not really mean that the food has become safer, because obviously this is the impact of the COVID pandemic. So these data are useful, but they can lead you to false conclusions if you look at them, say, only through the data as they are given. And that all has to do with the fact that these reported cases are only the tip of the iceberg of what is really happening in the population. There is a lot of what we call underestimation. So the true number of cases is here at the bottom of the pyramid. That's what you actually want to know. But you only get the tip of the iceberg. And thinking about what needs to happen before a case is reported, obviously the person who becomes ill will need to seek some kind of medical care. If they don't seek medical care, they're never identified as a patient. And so that's what we call under-ascertainment. But even if a patient goes to the doctor will not always ask for a specimen to be sent to a lab. If the lab gets a specimen, they must test for that organism. Right? They don't test for the organisms in all samples that they get. If they do, and if their test is sufficiently sensitive and specific, you get a confirmed case, but then they still have to report it to the authorities, which again is an area where you can lose. So there's also, even when a person is recognized as a patient by the healthcare system, there's a lot of underreporting. So a lot of countries, the US, the Netherlands, Denmark, the European Union as a whole, Australia, New Zealand, high income countries mainly, are working on trying to understand the proportion of cases that moves from one step in the pyramid to the other, and then use Monte Carlo simulation methods to reconstruct the pyramid, going down to estimates of the total number of people who fall ill. But then you still don't have an estimate of foodborne disease, because not all these illnesses, of which you saw the names in one of the first slides, is actually transmitted through food. They can also be transmitted through water or direct contact with animals, or human to human transmission, or through the environment. So the next step is then source attribution. And Sarah, when she did her PhD work, authored a review that is still considered one of the leading reviews in this area. She defined source attribution as partitioning of the human disease burden of one or more infectious diseases to specific sources of exposure. And this definition, I think, is generic. It doesn't only hold for foodborne diseases, it holds for every disease. For example, even COVID-19, there is the idea that partly it could be transmitted through contact with contaminated surfaces or other pathways. So every disease, although there can be a very dominant pathway, but there will always be parts of the transmission by other pathways. And we typically, certainly in the area of foodborne disease, take a two-step process for this attribution. First, attribute to these major pathways, food, environment, animal contact, human-to-human transmission is often used, but not always. And then within food, we attribute to specific food groups like beef, dairy, produce, fish, those kind of things. And that's a mechanism that has been used in many studies. To get a little bit more detail about the data that are available, this is a diagram that we've drawn some 10 years ago now, where looking at a lot of foodborne diseases have animal reservoirs. That was the focus here, but you could also add the environment as an amplifying reservoir. And that has all kinds of pathways that can transmit the pathogens ultimately to humans, environment, the food chain, direct contact. And you can zoom in more. You can go to specific exposures like drinking water, recreation water, meat. And you can even go to specific risk factors, meat on a barbecue, drinking unpasteurized milk, all those kind of things. And depending on the study design that you're using, you get different types of information. For example, if you do case control studies comparing sick and healthy people, or outbreak studies looking at causes of outbreaks, you're typically working at the bottom of this diagram. You get a lot of information about the vehicles that have transmitted the disease, the risk factors that were involved, but you get very little information about where these bacteria ultimately came from. So root causes are typically not well recognized. On the other hand, there are studies where we compare genotypes or other typing methods of the bacteria in the reservoirs and in the humans. So they give us the big picture of what are the reservoirs, but they don't tell us anything about how do these organisms travel. And then we can do comparative risk assessments where we model the fate and the behavior of these organisms throughout the whole chain, which in theory is a method that can give us all the answers, but the data needs of these methods and the resource needs are huge. So the application is limited just by the vast volume of work and data that you need. And there are data around from all of these, say, scattered domains, but there are no algorithms that we can use to really combine all this data in, say, an analytical approach. So this is where the power of the human mind, as I like to call it, comes to help. And we call upon that using expert elicitation studies that basically are able to embrace all the data from all these different domains, different types of data sources, and try to get a best estimate using that information. So another conclusion from Sarah's paper, data-driven methods are available for a limited number of hazards to attribute within the food pathway. I don't know, this is not from Sarah's, this is my own conclusion. So you can do something for Salmonella, for Campylobacter, once you've attributed it to food. But expert elicitation is the only available method for major pathway attribution and all relevant hazards. So that's what people have been using. In the early, I think in 2015, a Canadian group published a systematic review of expert elicitation methods to inform their choice of a method for source attribution of enteric illness. So they didn't only review source attribution studies, but all more generally source attribution expert elicitation studies. They picked out 59. I think there were more. When I look at it, I think there's quite a few missing. But anyway, so they were looking at all kinds of characteristics. So out of those 59 studies, only 23 did training of the experts. Pilot testing was done in 17. Background information, a large share, but still far from complete. Different elicitation methods with questionnaires dominating. Dissemination mainly by electronic means, even though the studies were looking back 1990 to 2012. Also mail, phone, or just not stated in the study. About half and half quantitative and more qualitative and semi-quantitative methods. And aggregation, as you can see, they only had data for 35 studies. Half of these were using some kind of weighting, but only 5 of them were using calibration questions. And then there were studies in something they called exclusion filter. I'll come back to that. And half of the studies did simple unweighted linear pooling. So quite a mixed bag of methods that certainly at that time were used. But I think if you would do the same review now, you'll still see that. So one of the reviews that, again, these authors made is that while there are various epidemiological and microbiological methods available to explore sources of attribution of enteric illness, expert elicitation provides an opportunity to identify gaps in our understanding, and where such studies are not feasible or available, represent the only possible method for synthesizing knowledge about the transmission. So again, the message is, apart from the few data that we directly have on disease transmission, there's a lot of other data out there, qualitative data, sometimes on the ecology, what kind of products can these bacteria grow in, survive in, what do we know about numbers, all kinds of information that we would like to include in an algorithm, but simply don't have the algorithm yet. So I'm now going to some of the studies that we did. This is the first study published in 2008 for the Netherlands. And I'll use that first to sort of structure the domain a little bit more. And this structure has been used by all the other studies that followed, at least that I'm describing in this way. So again, we have this domain from the reservoirs, now slightly broader, the environment, plants, animals, food and companion animals, going for food through some kind of processing, preparation, consumption, and then leading to human exposure. And we split it up here in foodborne, environmental, human-to-human, direct animal contact, and separately looked at travel-related cases, which are not under control of a national authority. So you want to sort of separate them out. A lot of national studies separate out travel-related cases as something that's not under their control. And then a very important decision is the point of attribution. So like we discussed, you can attribute at this level. You can attribute basically at every level. So defining very clearly for the experts what is the level of the point of attribution is a key requirement in these studies. And so you can attribute at the reservoir level, somewhere in between, it's sometimes called the kitchen door. If the food comes into the kitchen or arrives, say, in the living environment of the patient, that can be a relevant point, certainly for legislation. Most often, studies choose the level of exposure. So try to dissect this at the level of exposure. And then you can see here an example of how we structure the domain. So we have those five main pathways, and then you have all the different, the specific food groups. And again, there's no standardized way of doing that. It depends partly on whom you're working for, what the exact decision problem is. But there seems to come some kind of, say, continuity in the literature about this. Pathogens typically are a large number. In this study, I think we had some a small 20. Some of the other studies that you see even had more pathogens. So it's a complex domain in the sense that you've got a lot of transmission pathways, and you've got a lot of pathogens that you want to evaluate on. So there's always, there's a lot of combinations, food hazard combinations, pathway hazard combinations that need to be evaluated. So the burden for the experts can be quite big. So in this study, we had 16 experts. We interviewed them by email. In the end, this study was done quite a bit in a hurry, mainly because the contract between Delft and RIVM took so long to arrange that we didn't have a lot of time to do the actual work. We let the experts choose the pathogens they felt comfortable evaluating. And that resulted in 2 to 12 experts per pathogen. And we asked them for the 90% interval of their estimates of the transmission by each pathway pathogen pair. And so we didn't ask it jointly. We asked for single numbers per pathogen pathway pair. And then we did not use calibration questions here. And I think the only reason Roger let me get away with that is because we had so little time. In the end, we looked at all the results and in our wisdom decided to remove one expert because that expert had a very negative impact on the decision maker. And we also had other clues that the expert didn't really understand the questions that we were asking. So then you have estimates for every individual food hazard pathway. But of course, at this level of the major pathways, and also here, if this is, a full representation of all the pathways, everything has to add up to 100%. So the next step, and that's something that happens in all these studies, is that you have to then ensure that for every, say, iteration of your joint probability distribution, you get a 100% sum over all the pathways that you're modeling. And in this case, that was done by probabilistic inversion. And I think at that time, that was the answer to everything in Roger's group. Later, I haven't seen it being used anymore. Some of the results, and I'm not going to go very deep in this, but just want to focus on comparing the study here in the Netherlands with all the other columns. And if you just glance over it, you see that almost always the numbers here are lower. All the other studies estimated the foodborne proportion of transmission of all these pathogens. This is the foodborne proportion higher than our study. And we think that is because this is the first study where we explicitly told the experts, hey, you don't only get sick from Salmonella by food, you can also have a reptile in your home terrarium that can make you sick, or you can get it from going to a petting zoo and your baby touching an animal. So experts were much more explicitly considering, hey, there's other pathways here, and that resulted in much lower results than before. And studies that have replicated this design basically all come to the same conclusions that these earlier studies that only focused on foodborne disease transmission were vastly overestimating. And I'll remember this one here, the MEAT study, which was done, the first study in the USA. This was one of the drivers for the later study that I'll describe that we did for CDC. So then we became much more ambitious and thought if we can do it for the Netherlands, we can also do it for the world. And so there were there was one very large study set up by the World Health Organization with Tina Halt as the lead, with Billy Roger involved, myself as more the technical team. And two papers were published out of it, one presenting the estimates and then a more detailed analysis of the performance of the experts led by Willy. So this was a global assessment where the world was divided in 14 subregions. And we did assessments for 11 diarrheal pathogens, 7 other pathogens, invasive pathogens or parasites, and also for lead. We had 72 experts in the whole study. And based on their expertise and where they were and which parts of the world they knew about, we assigned them to 10 global panels. So these panels would do attribution for one or more specific hazards for all regions in the world. And also for some pathogens, we divided them off sub-regional panels. So they would do only attribution for the Americas or for Africa or for Asia, for example. So this resulted in 6 to 15 experts per panel. All interviews were done by telephone. This was 2010 or something. So Zoom and all that kind of stuff was not yet available. So a lot of telephone interviews. We did use seed and target questions and we asked them for the 5th, the 50th and the 95th percentile. And in the end, the performance-based decision maker was used and normalization in this case was done by Monte Carlo resampling. So just taking samples from the individual distributions, adding them up and dividing every sample by the sum of those samples across the pathways. So here you see that the combinations and the level of major pathways, so food, animal contact, human to human contact, the environment was split out more in more detail. And then also, and this is specifically for lead, there was interest in looking at paint, cookware, pottery or glassware and toys. So you can see that not every pathway was considered relevant for every hazard, but still it was a lot of hazard pathway combinations that were evaluated. The experts, the global distribution was reasonably good. You can see that there's still somewhat of a dominance of experts from North America and Europe. But we also did have a fair representation of experts from Latin America, from Africa, from Asia. Russia was underrepresented, but the whole input from Russia in this project has been negligible. Basically, the only thing we know about Russia is people who don't live there, but have been working either there or in some of the former Soviet republics. Calibration questions, they were tough. I thought they were very tough. Think about among all sub-regions in 2010, what was the proportion of reasonable vegetable oil that was imported rather than produced domestically in the sub-region with the highest such percentage. So you first have to think about what's the sub-region that has the highest percentage and then try to figure out what proportion are they importing. And these were all done by Sandy Hoffman. And I think even Sandy now asked the question in the latest FERG meeting, maybe they were a little bit too tough. So for the next iteration, we may rethink those calibration questions a little bit. Then go to the expert performance. You see here that most of the experts had a very high calibration information score and only a few, three, maybe five, had a an acceptable calibration score. So most experts basically overconfident and very few well calibrated experts. But nevertheless, the decision maker performance was relatively good. You can see that almost all decision makers had a good calibration. And that did not come at the cost of a lot of informativeness. The informativeness of the global waste decision makers are higher than of this is equal weight. Yeah, the blue ones are equal weight. So the informativeness actually increases in this particular setting. So we get better calibrated and more informative decision makers. Is that correct, Roger? Okay, then Willy also did an interesting analysis about, because we had so many experts about correlations between informativeness and accuracy. So each dot here is the rank correlation for one expert between informativeness and calibration, and it's ordered from the lowest to the highest accuracy. And so what you can see is that the experts with the lowest calibration had a negative correlation between informativeness and calibration, but if as the accuracy increased, that correlation became less and less negative and even became positive in for the best calibrated experts. And I think that's how Willy explained that we actually go from low informative to high informative decision makers when we filter out only the well calibrated experts. So in that sense, yeah, showing the power of the classical model in combining seemingly disparate results into something that is still credible. And then the results, I'm not going to go very deep in that. So what we did, we created a lot of these line graphs where you have the median estimate. And I think this is the 90 and the 95% uncertainty interval. What is interesting is that when you compare these regions, you'll see that all the regions that have an A, Americas, Europe, Western Pacific region, the calibrations or the percentage foodborne is typically higher than in the D and E regions, which are the lower income parts of the world. Probably very understandable because of much less hygiene, so environmental transmission through water, through soil, contact with animals is probably more likely. So even though these were different experts, these were not the same expert, this was where we had the subregional panels, but even though they were different experts, they still came to conclusions that sort of make a lot of intuitive sense, which sort of lends to the credibility of the results. LAT, this is for all pathways. You can see that foodborne transmission is considered something between 20 and 25% of all exposure to LAT is food. And then there's a lot of other pathways, air and soil, water and toys and cookware. So you could say that's also foodborne disease in a way, because it's added to the food. We even went deeper. We didn't only attribute to food or other pathways. We also had a sub-study for a limited number of pathogens, mainly those with an animal reservoir, to attribute to different food groups. So these questions were also answered by the experts, but ultimately published, led by Sandy Hoffman, who is now at USDA ERS. And here, the point of attribution actually defined at the kitchen door, because the group thought that was more informative for regulators. It's very difficult to regulate anything at the level of consumption, but you can regulate the quality of products that are sold to consumers in the marketplace. And again, not going into a lot of detail here, just to show you the complexity of the domain and the data that we're having. This is the attribution results for only one pathogen, the parasite Toxoplasma gondii. So attributed to all these different food groups in all these different regions in the world. So a huge study that has been done, and Sarah, Tina, Roger, really are now ready to start launching revisiting this study. The contract with WHO, the first part of the contract has been signed. So we're looking forward to doing all of this again and see how we think the world has changed in 10 years. Okay, next step, I moved to the United States and started talking to CDC, among others, about the poor data they were using to attribute their illnesses to food. Things hadn't changed a lot since the meat study, and the CDC basically said, well, it would be great if you and the team you work with could do a study for us to help us inform attribution of illnesses to pathways. So the setup was very much the same as the WHO study. Food and water were the goals, because CDC publishes estimates of the burden of foodborne disease approximately every 10 to 12 years. And they also wanted to start doing that for waterborne disease. So that was the focus of their work. So in this study, we had 33 pathogens, 48 experts now assigned over 15 panels, because again, not everybody knows of all these pathogens. So you can see the distribution of experts over the panels here. We had between 9 and 21 experts per panel, so quite sizable panels. Training was very extensive. We did a webinar to train them in the exact definitions of the food, of the transmission pathways. It took us half a year, I think, to get agreement but particularly within CDC on the exact definitions of these pathways, because it turned out that different groups in CDC use different definitions of the same concept. So we also helped to standardize their definitions a little bit. And then we had an in-person meeting in Atlanta, and the first morning was all about training in what is the method we're using, what is a 95% interval. So there was a lot of training being done by Willy, by Roger, by Tina about the technical aspects of the elicitation. And then they spent a day completing all the calibration and targets questions. We also included what we called a knowledge review of pathway definition. So we gave them scenarios, challenging scenarios, and asked them, do you consider this foodborne, waterborne, environmental, etc.? And use that as a test to see if the experts were really on par with our definitions. Because if every, say, expert at CDC has their own definition of a pathway, you can bet on it that every expert that you consult also has their own definition. So we tried to come to a point where we had shared definitions, and we came close, I could say. Not, of course, not perfect, but close. Again, we had seed and target questions, and we asked for the 5th, the 50th, and the 95th percentile. The domain, again, foodborne, waterborne, person-to-person, animal contact, environmental. And then we also defined some sub-pathways. So for the foodborne pathway, CDC, we can do a lot with data that we have. The only thing we cannot do is when food handlers contaminate the product. So we'd like you to sort that out. And for waterborne, we split the domain, recreational water, drinking water, and non-recreational, non-drinking. And for environmental sub-pathways, they were interested in was the ultimate reservoir an animal or a person. The data analysis was quite standard, but again intensive. performance weights, decision maker with item weights, weights was ultimately chosen. We also, because we knew that there were experts who were specialized more in water and others specialized in food, we did a subgroup analysis looking at people who self-identify as food experts or water experts. Is there a difference in transmission that may be related to schools of thought, which we did not find? Normalization again was by Monte Carlo resampling of the CVFs that came from Excalibur. Robustness analysis out of sample validation were done. And we also, when CDC saw the results, they basically said, we'd like to have a little bit more detail on certain pathways. So we did some re-elicitation based on, say, added demands from CDC, the problem owner, but also partly based on expert feedback. Some expert gave us feedback that some questions were not really clear. So we clarified that and asked them if, given that clarification, they wanted to adjust their estimates. So there was some post-elicitation being done. The expert performance in this study was exceptional. I don't know if it's still the case, but at that time, Roger said the best performing expert panel that he had ever seen. Almost half of the panel was well calibrated with an accuracy above 0.05. And you can see that the informativeness of all the experts was very high. There is probably a slight negative tendency here from informativeness going up on the accuracy scale, but it's very weak. So a lot of well-calibrated, highly informative experts, partly, hopefully, we like to think based on the extensive training that we did and the fact that we were able to do an in-person session here, partly just also probably because experts here in the US are very well trained and very knowledgeable about their domain. So we'll never know, say, in how far it was the approach that we took, but we'd like to take some credit for it. The decision maker, of course, was also very well calibrated. You can see here, this is the accuracy of the equal weight and the performance weight decision maker. And this is the informativeness, again, increasing compared to the equal weight decision maker. So in the results, very good results that were obtained in this study. And we found a nice way to sort of visualize the results in one simple plot. I think it took Tina days to create this plot, but in the end it worked out. So here you see it's obviously only the mean of this elicitation. So and every row here, everything should add up to 100%. So you very quickly see which these are parasites. We also have it for bacteria, but that's so big that it's not really visible in a slide. See that there's only two. Only one parasite and one virus that have a large foodborne transmission, and then there's a couple of parasites that have dominantly waterborne transmission, and here's one that's considered to be mainly environmental, and then here the virus is mainly person-to-person transmission. So this is a great plot. What I'm still dreaming of is to make this dynamic and take the samples, 10,000 samples, and have it moving before your eyes. But that may be something that a nice challenge for a student to once make. Okay, comparison with previous studies. So this is the former US study and again, you'll see when you compare that the numbers that we arrived at are typically lower for foodborne transmission because, again, we asked the experts to consider the whole domain and not only what proportion is foodborne without having to sacrifice anything for a high proportion of foodborne disease. So these results are considered more credible. CDC already has published estimates for the burden of waterborne disease based on these results, and they are almost ready to publish new estimates of foodborne disease. They told me it will be sometime next year. Last study I want to spend some time on is a study we did in Africa, where data are even more scarce. So we worked in three African countries, Ethiopia, Burkina Faso, and Rwanda. And the questions, I don't even have a slide with the questions. So the question we wanted to know again is attribution pathogens to specific foods. We had FERG estimates for attribution to foods, but we wanted to zoom in on specific foods. So these were all remote interviews, although we did quite a bit of training again. We had a training video. We did training in the interviews. There were about 2 hours per expert through Zoom. So we did an effort to train the experts. But when you look at the results, you'll see that none of the experts was well calibrated in neither of the studies. But still, when you then look at the decision maker, in all three studies, the decision maker was well calibrated and the informativeness somewhere between 1 and 2. So still, even though we had only uncalibrated experts, still the decision makers were acceptable in their performance. I'll just show you some of the results. This is another way that you can sort of simplify the complex domain in one plot. This is a tree map, and this cost me a couple of days to prepare, but it was fun doing. So you can see this, for example, this yellow here is attribution of Campylobacter to poultry, and then the sub attribution to poultry cooked at home, bought raw, eaten out of home, or cooked at home, bought processed. Here you can see Salmonella, or let's take ETEC here. You can see that ETEC is a large part is attributed to vegetables, and then within the vegetables, green peppers, tomatoes, eaten raw or cooked, fruit and nuts, leafy greens. So there's a lot of information in each individual tree map. And again, I'd like to see that moving based on the samples rather than only on the means. So if anybody has a student who likes to do that kind of programming stuff, let me know. So my conclusions, attribution of diseases to food is very complex, and it's a non-standardized domain. And data-driven methods can only provide partial answers. We don't have these algorithms that we would like to have to combine the different qualitative and quantitative types of evidence. So structured expert judgment methods have successfully been used in different settings to fill that gap. And I think what we also see, but maybe I'm a little bit lopsided, is that the classical model is increasingly accepted as the preferred method in this domain, despite its increased complexity. And I remember when I first presented the method to WHO and showed the manual that Roger and his colleagues, Louis Gosens, had developed, outlining the different steps in the expert elicitation process. And somebody in the FERG committee said, hey, this is just like science. And I'll leave it at that.